Fordham in New York. It is September 1980. Curtain time at Flushing Meadow, where two men finally meet for the championship of the United States in tennis, better known as the U.S. Open. A Viking from Sweden has landed, intent on winning this championship. He is Bjorn Runeborg. He has won Wimbledon 5 straight times, but he has never conquered the United States. No, that territory belongs to a young man from only a few miles distant, John Patrick McEnroe Jr., the youngest United States champion in decades. These are the two best tennis players of their time, two of the greatest money-making machines ever in sport. For Borg and McEnroe, tennis is war. And let me tell you what it means to a supposedly civilized country called France. They're watching at 2 a.m. live. John Patrick McEnroe Jr. has made tennis bigger than ever. Like a select few in life, McEnroe conquers all. He goes beyond his sphere. There are people like that in every game. Politics, entertainment, business, sport. The Muhammad Ali, Brando, Baryshnikov, Mick Jagger. He's a magician, a showman, a super performer, but a conquering hero when he steps onto the court. John McEnroe, at 21. This is his story. It's not very long ago, but it seems quite a ways back. Spring of 1978, Stanford University, Palo Alto, California. Stacy Margolin, number one at the University of Southern California, visits him on the campus during practice. They have a common passion, tennis. Stacy's not the only visitor. Frequently, Barry McKay, the promoter of the San Francisco and San Jose tournaments, former U.S. Davis Cup player, a television commentator, drops by Palo Alto just to keep up the friendship. McEnroe is a player a promoter will always want in his tournaments. McKay is on good terms with Stacy and John.
How long have I known him?
Yeah.
Oh, about 4 years or so.
And now you're more than casual friends, I think, right? I mean, I know you're here to practice a little bit, but...
Yeah.
So tell me what it's like when you watch. I mean, I know you watched him play at our tournament. Is it difficult? I mean, do you get nervous?
I just don't like to see him get too upset with himself and the linesman and stuff
right.
like that, because he plays better when he keeps his composure. And...
Have you talked about that at all?
Yeah. Certain time, it just depends if he makes up his mind to, you know, be a good boy or whatever.
Right, really.
I heard that when he was in the juniors, when he was really little, his temper was really bad. Then it's gotten better.
Stanford, a time of testing himself against his peers for John McEnroe. Dual matches against other colleges, such as this one with the University of California at Los Angeles. Tradition. At UCLA, the tennis tradition goes back a long way. Jimmy Connors, 1971, Arthur Ashe, 1965, Alan Fox, 1961, all national intercollegiate champions. Stanford, more of a latecomer, but Roscoe Tanner was developed there, the Mayer brothers, Sandy and Gene. Here is where the champions get their educations.
Today we have the number one and two teams in the country. The number one team, defending national champions, Stanford. UCLA Bruins, number two ranked in the country, undefeated, and defending Pac-8 champions. Now the singles matchups, number one singles. From Stanford, number 10th ranking player, in the United States, and a semifinalist at Wimbledon, a freshman from New York, John McEnroe. He'll be playing from UCLA, a freshman, number 3 in the world, juniors, from Palos Verdes, California, undefeated, Elliot Tosher.
From across town, the Southern California campus, comes Stacy Margolin with her mother, Anita Margolin. Los Angeles is the vineyard of tennis in the United States. It's produced more good players and more good tennis than any other area. When Stanford comes to Los Angeles to play UCLA, everybody interested in tennis turns out. It is a rivalry that goes back to junior days, Telcher against McEnroe, and it means a lot on this day in 1978. Just a college match, but you're putting in two guys who are world-class players. Telcher wins the first set. Not a happy prospect for Dick Gould, the Stanford coach. Who's number one? The great question, of course, in sport. And this match will decide who's the number one player in intercollegiate tennis in the United States for the year 1978. Elliot Telcher or John McEnroe. The match will come down to 1 point, really. Telcher has won the first set, and now it's 5-3 in the second. Match point against McEnroe. This is the moment of truth. Sharing the match point tension, as well as Stacy and her mother, are their coaches, Dick Gould of Stanford and Glenn Bassett of UCLA. A match point for Telcher, a sudden death point. And McEnroe has saved the match. This will be another of John McEnroe's trademarks, saving match points, tap dancing through a minefield before going on to win. Who knows where he learned it, but he definitely worked at it. It was a major course, perhaps. He studied it in his college year. Only 1 year of college, but he comes out with a PhD in saving match points. Telcher that day would learn, too. He had his chance. He had his prey wounded in McEnroe. But he didn't finish him off. You only get one shot sometimes. And if you miss, you may have to turn around and run for your life. You have to learn that tennis is like life in the jungle. Now Elliot Telcher, who has held a match point, faces one. The regular college season is almost over, and yet the climax lies ahead, the National Intercollegiate Championships. But all the while, John McEnroe is leading a double life. He's the big man on the college team, but on the professional circuit, he's the kid, the amateur, the curiosity.
There's quite a contrast in this doubles finals. One team is playing together for the first time, and the other has played together, it seems, forever. To the umpire's right is a team that's not only unseeded, but this is the first tournament they've ever played together as a team. Individually, they're two of the best tennis players in the world. But as a doubles team, not having played together, they were a real question mark. Well, they were each looking for a partner. They decided to join forces, figuring they could at least give a few teams a little competition. And lo and behold, they surprised everybody but themselves in reaching the finals. Ladies and gentlemen, the nation's newest dynamic duo of tennis, Arthur Ashe and John McEnroe.
Thank you.
Arthur, this was a very interesting day here at the Smith Center. You're 34, McEnroe is 15 years younger, never played a tournament with him before, and you almost beat Smith and Lutz for the title. What do you think of this kid?
I think he's probably more talented than he realizes, but I think also when he leaves Stanford intermittently to play tournaments with us, he comes to play in a level a bit higher than he's used to at school. But I enjoyed playing with him. As you say, we almost pulled it off.
I saw you a couple of times when he was mad, yelled something at a lineswoman. I saw you kind of cringe.
Well, there's no question that every time he goes into one of those blue moods of his, he's liable to lose the next 2 points worrying about the last one. That's what really happened in doubles a couple of times, and I'm trying my best not to get in the way of a free expression of the anger, but I also think that in the long run, probably for his own good, somebody possibly like myself needs to just tell him that he's got to take the bad calls with the good calls.
Do you feel a little fatherly out there with him?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, a little paternalistic, I guess so, yeah.
I didn't even think you'd reach that since the last return.
Yeah.
That last shot, that lob, was a good play. I mean, just you got that shot, but try it if you like. Because once you make it, you're going to make it back up. And then when he backs up, you just hit that loop, you know, that little point.
It's different, Arthur. When you were in college, there was no thought of giving up any college. You wanted that degree. There was no professional tennis that you were going to jump into.
No.
Do you think this kid should finish his college?
No, I think he's talented. I think if he wants to be the best player in the world, he should stop.
He's got to stop now.
After this year, yes.
Well, I think that's on his mind.
Yeah.
We look forward to more doubles from Papa Ash and Johnny McEnroe.
I hope you'll be able to play out in San Jose.
I'll be there, I guarantee you that.
Good, good. In fact, I'd like to have you and Arthur be a team, which would be spectacular.
But I think Arthur's giving up on me.
No. You guys are just getting going together. Right. Yeah. Right. Why not?
Do you know what Barry did? Before you were born, 2 years before you were born, 1957, he won the national intercollegiate title for Michigan.
He's old, eh?
And when you were 6 years old, Arthur won the national intercollegiate title for the University of California, Los Angeles.
How old was I when you won it?
You weren't around for much of this, John, but this was interesting, wasn't it, Barry, to see these two guys playing together?
It was great. It was great. I think they're a good team.
And they had a good shot at beating Smith and Lutz. Two love 40 games in the second set. If they could have put across 1 point either one of those games.
They got one in.
Well, that's the way it goes.
Well, I can't completely say I hope he went to NCAA, because he didn't go to UCLA.
Well, he's going to Stanford. And you still carry that enmity, do you?
Yes, I do.
A UCLA man all the way.
Don't like the Cardinals.
What a lineup. McKay, McEnroe, Ash. Two former champions and one guy who just might make it.
Might.
Athens, Georgia, a college town. For 8 days in May every year, it is the hub of American college tennis. 64 players out of all the thousands who play college tennis in the United States come here to decide who is their champion. This is the National Collegiate Athletic Association Championship. Call it what you will, the NC2A, the NCAA. This is one of the oldest tennis tournaments in history. 1883 it began. For the first few years, they were all Eastern dudes who claimed this title. Yale, Harvard, Princeton, that sort of thing. Not anymore. The swing is to the West. California and Texas. Those are the teams. And this year, Stanford comes in as the favorite. Stanford, UCLA, Southern California, Pepperdine, Southern Methodist, and Trinity from Texas. Those are the names to look out for, the teams from the West. And the best in the West is supposed to be John McEnroe, Jr., a Stanford guy on his way to the pro. John McEnroe, oh yeah, people point to John McEnroe. There he is, Wimbledon semifinalist, doesn't mean a thing. Makes these guys, his peers, want to beat him even more, want to have the scalp of the Wimbledon semifinalist. Right now, he's just one of us, they say. Wimbledon is a long way away, Johnny McEnroe. That's someplace in England where the grass is green. Right here, the concrete, and perhaps the competition, is a lot harder. Now he's in the quarterfinals, and the going is tougher. Against Eric Iskersky of Trinity in San Antonio, he has to go three sets. And along the way, McEnroe shows the Georgians one of his alleged charms. He brings the spectators into the match.
One more word, sir, and you're going to leave the stadium.
I'm clapping when I want to. I will not, sir. I paid my tickets, and if he's out of order, he said bad words.
I don't care.
You should stop.
You be quiet. You worry about his bad words, okay? Just be quiet.
What are you going to do about it? No, then what are you going to do about it? Aren't you the umpire? Aren't you the umpire?
He's too bold to talk.
Johnny, here you go.
You know, if anyone's going to beat me, they're going to have to beat me. You know, I'm not going to try to beat myself down there, so
right.
Hopefully I'll... Yeah, I'd like to win the tournament, but I'll still turn pro whether I win or lose it.
Right.
Oh, I'm just going to look at it as it's my last college tournament. It'd be a nice thing to win.
And a mystery figure. The lone cowboy of the tournament. Not from Texas, though. The cowboy, the Mad Marine, some people call him, for his crew cut, is John Sadry from Charlotte, North Carolina. He's from the Wolf Pack, North Carolina State, not a tennis power by any stretch of anybody's imagination except Sadry's. He imagines himself as becoming the champion. And this is where people begin to take John Sadry seriously. Quarterfinal match. His serve has been tearing up the courts through the week. Sadry and Telcher. Telcher, is he looking ahead to the championship match against McEnroe? This will be the first and last shot for John McEnroe and Elliot Telcher. They come in 1-2. McEnroe seeded 1, Telcher seeded 2, because McEnroe won that match at UCLA. It's as narrow as that between the number 1 and 2 seeds. They are to meet in the final, but it will not be for Elliot Telcher. In John Sadry, he sees someone who can beat him, who can hit serves through him. And Sadry does. Telcher's college career is over. 1 year, a very good year, but no championship. A bright newcomer to college coaching, Alan Fox of Pepperdine, discusses the tournament with Dan McGill, the Georgia coach and the chairman of the tournament.
This is the third time that the championship's been held here in Athens. How would you compare this year's championship as far as the amount of people, the excitement, and so forth, to the first time or two?
This is greatest championship ever. Most all the coaches think it's the greatest ever. Of course, we thought it was the greatest championships we'd ever had here in 1972. It was the biggest crowds ever see the championships, and it was a fantastic field. We didn't know it was a fantastic field until a few years later. Some boys like Stockton, who won it, and Gottfried, who was runner-up, who did so well in the pros, and in that field also was Sandy Mayer and Ramirez and Eddie Dibbs and Roscoe Towner and the Gullickson twins and McNair. A lot of people think it was as good a field as it ever been. But this year's even better.
You know, this McEnroe thing has been kind of growing along as far as he's been getting into it with the crowd from time to time. Today they had a couple of real scenes where...
John McEnroe is just one of those...
What do you think?
...fiery competitors. He's a spitting image of Ty Cobb, the Georgia boy, you know. He was born just up the road from Athens, and John McEnroe... I think is from the same mold, and I think maybe he may be misunderstood sometimes, but I think that he'll work all that out and just be a great all-round champion and go on to be one of the all-time greats.
Do you think there are elements in the crowd that are actually trying to incite McEnroe to get themselves involved in the actual match?
See, what we have now, what the general public is has seen now in tennis, you know. They have seen that tennis is one of the greatest competitive sports of all, and they didn't know that before. Until they had television, tennis is just as competitive as a boxing match or a basketball game and a baseball game. And the crowds that come out there to see baseball and basketball and boxing and football, they like to get involved. And they're getting involved in the tennis, and there's nothing we can do about it.
In the first semifinal, it's Sadri against Eddie Edwards, a South African who plays for Pepperdine. Although Edwards fights to the three-set limit, he will be bludgeoned by the serve of Sadri.
I don't really think I'm intimidating them, but I am playing awfully well. I played real well last week, and that's given me some confidence for this week. And I've been booming my serve in. Today I hit something like 16 aces. So I've just been serving real well, and that's helped me throughout the tournament.
Yeah. I mean, every time, when you get an easy one at the net, and it was a short overhand, I mean, you hit it with awesome power. I mean, you crunch it.
Yeah, I usually just hit those as hard as I can and take a little bit of anger out on the ball.
In the second semifinal, John McEnroe against his teammate and doubles partner, Bill Mays. Friend or teammate, it doesn't matter to John McEnroe. He's going to fight for every point. The teams that came in as families will spread. But they will remember these last days in Athens. They were the 1978 National Intercollegiates.
What is there to fear from the darkness that surrounds us? I don't really know the way, but that's okay. As long as we're together.
when I was 12 or 13, I probably worshipped Rod Laver.
How do you beat these guys, the guys of your age and some of the really fine players? How do you do it?
I don't know. I mean, I don't think I have any real weaknesses. You know, I don't really serve, you know, I'd like to improve my serve a little, and I certainly need work in my volley, and I've been brought up on clay, so, you know, I feel comfortable in the backcourt, and, you know, it's just a matter of playing the big points well, and, you know, I just try to make them win the big points, and if they're not going to win it, then it gives me an opportunity to, you know, win some matches.
Months of preparation, college matches, tournaments, practice have led up to this moment. It's either John Sadrey, unexpected in the final from North Carolina State, or John McEnroe, the favorite from Stanford, who will wear the crown, intercollegiate champion for 1978. Watch John Sadrey serve. Most dramatic, the most destructive shot in tennis. 24 times Sadrey does this. That's enough to win an entire set. 24 points. What a handicap for a player to erase when he's aced that many times. The match goes back and forth. McEnroe, he cannot win the battle against Sadrey's serve, but every once in a while he steals a loaf of bread. He grabs one of the serving points in the tiebreaker. Man who can play that tense passage, the tiebreaker, can win. And in college, it's even tougher than out on the pros. This is the sudden death tiebreaker. It's a sprint, the first one to five. No lingering death. You don't have to be ahead by two. At 4 points all, it's simultaneous set point, sometimes simultaneous match point. It is sudden death. In some ways, to a young man like John McEnroe, this means more than Wimbledon. Sure, he was a semifinalist at Wimbledon, but that was somewhere else. This is his time among his peers. Winning this tournament puts your name in the book, in the Bible of tennis. Stan Smith, Arthur Ashe, Jimmy Connors, Tony Trabert, Pancho Segura, just go back. Now is it all catching up with John McEnroe. Sadrey wins the third set, very much in the match, and McEnroe is down. The back spasms come. Has he tried to do too much? He's played 17 matches in 8 days in singles and doubles. The heat is scorching, 90 degrees. They puddle in the humidity. This is the test. Sadrey, the unknown, is playing like a champion, the champion he wants to be. It's a test of everything. Stamina, character, emotional balance, everything. As the two of them battle to the very last point.
McEnroe hits a tremendous backhand passing shot. Sadrey can't handle the speed, dumps the backhand in the net, and it's over. Fantastic drama. McEnroe is absolutely ecstatic, jumping off the ground, flings his racket into the net, rushes to the net, falls into Dick Gould's arms. What a tremendous effort.
Exceedingly well played match. the winner of the greatest amateur tennis tournament in the world, as he was last summer, the youngest player ever to reach the semifinals at Wimbledon. He is the NCAA's youngest single champion, a relentless competitor at his best when the chips are stacked their highest, John McEnroe of tennis.
Yes, he's champion. King for a day, you might say, because the National Intercollegiates will be quickly behind and John McEnroe joins the rat race of the pros. He's got to fight his way to the top once again. After that tournament. But could you, in your, if you were hallucinating, imagine what has happened to you since then?
I guess I'd hope that.
4 months have passed, and the dropout is making it. McEnroe returns to the Stanford territory for the tournament in San Francisco, the Transamerica, and this will be his first major professional victory, beating Eddie Dibbs and Dick Stockton in the semifinals and the final. Alan Fox, the tennis coach at Pepperdine, a student of tennis psychology, discusses the young man's rapid success.
What would you say is the one single quality that has brought John McEnroe so far so quickly?
Well, extreme physical and mental talent. Well, he's got a very rough, competitive mind.
Rough competitive mind, yeah.
He's able to stand in there, keep pounding his best shots, come what may. Pressure, no pressure. He doesn't fold mentally.
Is he going to go up, 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 or is he, like a lot of the young players, going to be spoiled by the big money so fast?
Yeah, I don't think the money will make any impact on him at all. Not a bit.
Well, if the money doesn't make any impact, certainly John McEnroe is going to make one hell of an impact on the game of tennis.
As a college player, he dominated this year as very few people have. I didn't know how he'd stack up against the pros on a day-to-day basis. Here, he's showing that it was no fluke and he's really there already. He is one of the few people that has everything. And when I say everything, I mean he serves viciously. He's extremely fast on his feet. Great balance.
Athleticism.
Tremendous. And usually when you have those two things, your hands won't be that good. And he's got great hands also.
How do you define great hands in a tennis player?
Control, mobility, flexibility. What he can do is he can take the most powerful shot and take the sting out of it with his hands. He softens it up, controls it like a shock absorber, throws it back into the court. He has one favorite play, and that is he's got this very, very mean left-handed serve wide in the ad court with a sliding serve. Gets it in that very quickly and just takes all the power off the volley. He doesn't drop volley it, but he just lays it in the court short, and his opponent can never reach it.
As 1978 fades, we're looking at the most successful transition ever in the history of this game of tennis. Moments ago, a college boy. Now the winner of a major professional title in San Francisco. A man on his way to millions. But is it just a flash? Transamerica doubles with his new partner, Peter Fleming, McEnroe participates in a dramatic changing of the guard, defeating an all-time team of Stan Smith and Bob Lutz. This establishes a pattern. McEnroe will not be just a singles player, he'll be a complete tennis player. Fleming and McEnroe will go on to win Wimbledon in the following season and defeat Smith and Lutz again for the U.S. Open title. But let's not anticipate. It is 1:15 in the morning as these kids mob John McEnroe. They've stayed up for something special. They can sense it. This is the apprenticeship of a star.
The number one seed in our tournament from nearby Douglaston, New York, a local boy who made good in a big way, the defending champion. Let's welcome John McEnroe.
The occasion was the Masters. The second week in January, 1980, played in Madison Square Garden in freezing New York. Eight men came here, the elite of tennis, the top finishers on the Grand Prix circuit. After round-robin play, four remain, the semifinalists. Connors, McEnroe, Borg, Garolaitis, four players, but hundreds were involved in the system called the Grand Prix. More than 90 tournaments in the Grand Prix. It's taken a year to play it. This is the longest sporting season of all. Tennis is perhaps the most complex sport in its management. And so we've come up with a 13-month year. The Masters, deciding who is number one for 1979, is not played until the 1980 Grand Prix has begun. In one of the semifinals, Vitas Garolaitis against the 1977 champion, Jimmy Connors. For years, Vitas has been frustrated by Jimmy. 16 straight matches Connors has won since the only Garolaitis victory. But today, it will be different. Garolaitis is going to win and get to the final. But it's the other semifinal. It's on everyone's mind. Borg against McEnroe. John McEnroe is seeded first. That's because he was number one in the Grand Prix. He's number two on the professional computer behind Bjorn Borg. But in this tournament, he is seeded number one and Borg number two. They are even in their matches for the year. When they collide, it means number one for 1979. Two artists on the court. McEnroe is the artist of the soft brush stroke. Strong impressions. McEnroe is a painter.
Yeah.
Borg is a sculptor with a hammer pounding on granite.
Yeah, I think it's important to tennis that there are different personalities. I think, you know, for example, if everyone was like Bjorn, tennis wouldn't be what it was like. And if everyone was like me, you know, maybe people, you know, a lot of people would be walking out sometimes. But I think it's important to have that mixture. I think when Bjorn and I play, for example, it's a good thing because you have him with just the way we play are different and the way we act on the court are different, and the way we react to certain things are different. I think that's what makes a great match. As you know, that's what's important to keep up when some of the top players have rivalries going or whatever they want to call it. I mean, I think that's important for tennis to keep up going.
John McEnroe won this championship a year ago. This is how he really made his name as a champion. The Masters of 1978. He beat Arthur Ashe, and now he has the first set under control. He has a set point. And he has the Swede scrambling. It's set up for the set. Oh. How can he miss that shot? How can he miss that shot? 19,000 people have seen him miss it. He's thinking about it. What hold does the Swede have on John McEnroe that he would miss that shot?
Borg winning Wimbledon four times, that's when I think you can really be up there with the great players of all time.
Bjorn Borg is the one player that John McEnroe respects. McEnroe thinks he can handle anybody else in the world. Handle him, beat him up, knock him dead. He knows he can beat Borg. He's done it before. But there's something in those deep, blue, frigid eyes of Borg that makes other players quiver and gains McEnroe's respect. He thinks about a set point that was his. The set was over. No way Borg could win that set. Instead, the set goes on, and McEnroe must work three more games to get to another set point, here in the tiebreaker. Yeah! He does win the first set, but something was shaken in him when he missed that easy set point. Maybe only a bookkeeper or somebody at the Internal Revenue Service would be interested in the exact figures, but I think it's interesting to see what has happened to tennis and what has happened to John McEnroe. His first 6 months as a professional, in 1978, he made $445,000 in prize money. Who knows what he made in exhibition matches, endorsements, and for him, it was only a half year. Now, in 1979, John McEnroe made over $1 million in prize money for just one season. So did Bjorn Borg. And at the end of 1979, John McEnroe's total prize money for just about 18 months as a professional was $1,450,000, an odd change that he probably left around the living room. In 17 years as a professional, Kenny Rosewall made just about the same figure. Well, you say, galloping inflation in action. Well, it's also galloping McEnroe.
Would say it's been too much too soon for John McEnroe.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't know how long I'm going to be around. I mean, I might not be around 10 more years, but I don't really feel like, I feel like there's a lot more I can accomplish in tennis.
Borg wins the second set. They're all even. What a year 1979 was for John McEnroe. Bjorn Borg, all right, number one in singles for the year, but here is something you cannot argue about. John McEnroe was the tennis player of the year. He played twice as many matches as anybody else. He won many more matches than anybody else. More than 200 matches he played because he played both singles and doubles and won it both. He was the complete tennis player. He set a record that was only phenomenal in 1979. He won 27 total tournaments. 10 in singles, 17 in doubles with Peter Fleming mainly. The previous record for the open era, the big money era that began in 1968, was by Ilie Năstase, the Romanian. Năstase won 25 tournaments in 1973. McEnroe beat it. 27 tournament victories. There may be nothing like it again in tennis.
What kind of season like that ever happen again?
I don't know, I probably won't ever play that many tournaments again.
But forget dollars and previous deeds. Now in Madison Square Garden, an elemental struggle approaches its climax. Now Borg is coming alive. After losing the first set, he's hardened up. But in the third set, McEnroe serves first. He takes the lead. Borg catches up over and over again. Here, Borg, 5-6, 30-all, and McEnroe needs only 2 points to master the sweep. 2 points. It's a classic fight to the finish. Those 2 points, but McEnroe doesn't get them, and so Borg catches up for a last time. 6-all, and they enter the decisive tiebreaker. The whole season coming down to this. One tiebreaker.
First service.
Ace. 1 point to zero. When you ace Bjorn Borg, you discourage him? Makes him mad. This is what McEnroe does to Bjorn Borg. He makes him reach to greater heights. Happiness for Bjorn Borg is his first victory in New York after 8 years of trying.
We have our finalists. You can call it a street fight, a battle, or a war, but the championship singles finals will take place tomorrow afternoon between Zetus Girolaitis and Bjorn Borg.
1979 will belong to Bjorn Borg, but he knows that he and John McEnroe will be meeting many times because this is the rivalry of the 1980s. Jimmy Connors, who has been the American player of the 1970s, finds suddenly the feisty John McEnroe in his way every way he turns. 1973 to 1979, Connors was undisputed number one in the United States. He won the U.S. Open 3 times. But in 1979, on this court, McEnroe knocked Connors out in the semifinals and seized the number one ranking.
The harder you hit it, the harder he hits it back. So, I mean, I'm not going to hit a hard ball at him the whole match. Just try to, when I come in, just try to chip, and you know, that chip that stays low on either side and just make him... I mean, the way he hits it flat, so it's got to come up. So, I mean, if I'm on top of the net, I should put away the volley.
And this semifinal is as momentous as any final ever played in America because it marks the end of the reign of Jimmy Connors. They meet once again in 1980 in the semifinals. Connors may have his revenge tonight, however, as he goes ahead in this match 2-1, and the day lengthens into night.
Tell me when you're going to get one right.
Mr. McEnroe, please.
What do you want, Mr. Whatever your name is?
Please play.
Incompetent.
Is any of your behavior ever contrived? You think, I'm going to let it all go right now?
I think really it's pretty much just me. You know, it's just, I'm really competitive on the court, and I mean, at times you regret doing it because it's probably not necessary, and, but you just, people don't realize that the pressure builds up, and all of a sudden you just got to let it out.
Has this hurt you, complaining during matches? Do you think it's caused you to lose matches, lose points, to lose your concentration?
No, it depends, like, to what extent. I think there's times where it helps because I get fired up or whatever. There's also definitely times where I've gotten upset about more than I should, and I've probably lost because of it. I mean, I'm still trying to work on it, and hopefully it'll use it to my advantage, but I still think there's times where it's hurt me, and hurt me more often than not, I guess. I think basically, when I question a call, I think I'm right. I don't question it just for the sake of questioning. I mean, maybe that their eyesight's bad or mine's, I mean, I don't know, but it's hard to understand. I mean, people can't understand it because, I think I see the line, and I mean, I just can't. When you think you've won a point and then they take it away, that's...
Because it's so painful for them to lose, champions always find a way to win. John McEnroe always finds a way to win. Vince Lombardi, the late coach of the Green Bay Packers, a master of motivation. This is what he said. Life's battles don't always go to the stronger or faster man, but sooner or later, the man who wins is the man who thinks he can. John McEnroe always thinks he can win. Vince Lombardi would have loved John McEnroe. Nice guys don't win in this game. Oh, there might be a few of them around, but basically, it's a sport for killers. This is kill or be killed for millions of dollars. Nobody buries you if you lose. They just forget you. And that's what the fear is. It's a competitive life where we all have to fight for whatever we get. Living space, jobs. And when we get them, somebody else wants them. And that's what's happening. That's what McEnroe is showing you out on a tennis court. I want it. I'm grabbing it. It's mine. Try and stop me. Is he a reflection of our times? Is he violence personified on the tennis court? Yes, McEnroe does disturb us. He's a genius who worries people because he's a reflection of the times we live in. Harsh, violent times. We can see in him what society has done to us. In life, as in tennis today, you're either a winner or a loser. You live in a reward system, and John McEnroe is a pure product of it. He is a winner.
Do you think of yourself as a winner? Is that something that crosses your mind?
Well, I guess I'm a winner. I mean, I did an ad for clothing company or whatever, like just dress clothes, and the name of the thing was Winners or whatever. I mean, that was a head thing.
Do you look down on losers? Are you afraid to be?
I guess that's what makes the world go around, that there's winners and losers, and that's what I strive to be. I mean, some people just can't understand how it could be to be number one. There's a lot of players that can't even imagine themselves, you know, being number one, but I can't imagine some people that don't try. You know, I think you got to go out there and give it what you got.
The lights come on at Flushing Meadow, and McEnroe seems to have blown it with petulance, raging at the umpire, losing all his senses, saying later, I went a little crazy out there. John McEnroe falls behind. And then he pulls himself right back into the match and into a fifth set. He has a chance to win it, but Connors comes back and they're into a tiebreaker. Now, for the first time in the history of the event, a semifinal will be decided in a lingering death tiebreaker. Hoping for his fourth title, if he can beat McEnroe here, Jimmy Connors, who first ruled in 1974, cannot overcome Junior McEnroe. In less than 20 hours, he returns to the same hard slab for the title match. Bjorn Borg has come into Queens for a ninth year,
looking for the U.S. Open title. Eight failures. He lost in the final of 1976 when the tournament was played at Forest Hills on clay to Jimmy Connors. But perhaps even more bitter than that were his failures in 1978 and 1979. In those 2 years, as in 1980, he was on his way to the Grand Slam, that rare accomplishment in tennis, the French, Wimbledon, United States, and Australian championships, all in the same year, done only by two men, Don Budge in 1938, Rod Laver in 1962 and 1969. In 1978, he got all the way to the final. He had won the French and Wimbledon, and Connors beat him. In 1979, once again, but in the quarterfinals, it was Roscoe Tanner. Bjorn Borg is the favorite to win the tournament. But a man hitting thunderbolts, Roscoe Tanner, takes him out in four sets. Tanner hitting the serve so hard that on one point, he knocks down the net. Now, in 1980, surely in 1980, he must make it. Many have conceded this championship to the Swede. They're getting ready for him in Australia. They're praying for him in Australia. Come down and make our tournament big. That will be the last leg. Already, newspaper men are changing their lives. Television networks are planning to go. Everybody wants to go to Melbourne for the Australian Open. But first, Borg must beat McEnroe. John McEnroe didn't care at all about a Grand Slam for Bjorn Borg. And at first, although Borg starts off quicker than usual, usually a slow starter, he serves twice for the first set at 5-4 and 6-5, and yet McEnroe stops him in the tiebreak. Bjorn Borg is stunned. He plays the second set in a daze. And there is McEnroe ahead 2-0. Is it total collapse? If you think so, you don't know Bjorn Borg. McEnroe is ready for the surge, and it comes. Borg winning the third set. Borg winning the fourth set. He's already rebounded in the quarterfinals against Tanner from 2-1 down. In the semifinals against Johan Kriek from 2-0 down. And now he's in the fifth set, and Bjorn Borg does not lose five set matches. He hasn't lost one in years. He's won 13 straight. Bjorn Borg in the fifth set is a lock. Everybody in the stadium knows it. He's revived. Bjorn Borg is going to win after all. Could not out-concentrate this man in the fifth set. Mentally, he was too strong to lose a fifth set. Sure, McEnroe could push it. McEnroe had all the talent. He did it at Wimbledon, but when it came down to the crunch at Wimbledon, it was Borg and the mental strength, reaching for more than any other man could muster. And would it be the same here? Borg. This was where he wanted McEnroe, in a fifth set. This was where he wanted McEnroe, he may have thought. Are the courts hard, unforgiving, fast? And those are words that characterize John McEnroe. This was his championship. He won it a year ago. Maybe the inspiration for McEnroe will come from the memories of 1979. That wall of concentration that is Borg would crumble now.
What do you want to be thought of when your career is over?
Basically, I think As a tennis player, not as, like, the way I am. I mean, I think Nasty, for example, no one's going to remember him because he's a great player. They're going to remember because of the way he acts. And
temperament.
I don't really want to be remembered.
Are you in danger of being remembered for bitching?
I think it's a possibility right now. I think people are going to remember Connors as a player, pretty much, but not Nasty. Because he's just gone way out of proportion. I mean, it's just, I don't want to be like that. I don't feel like I'm like him on the court. I don't feel like I'm like Connors. So I think that, hopefully, that people will start understanding whatever. Like, Connors had a tough time maybe when he was young, and now the people are really good to him. So hopefully it'll be the same for me, maybe sooner. But I feel like I'm my own I want to be remembered as my own person.
John, you were quoted once. Somebody said, what would you really like to be? And you said, I'd like to be a rock star. Was that an accurate quote?
Very accurate.
I don't think you're going to make it there. You may. I wish you well. But
There could be problems,
but don't you think in a way that you are a bit of a rock star? You have that sort of aura about you in this day, a tennis player, traveling the world.
I'm not your, what people had 10 years ago think your basic everyday tennis player that just walks out there. You have to say I was a personality, if nothing else.
John McEnroe had become a front page success, a mover, a cover boy. Someone people gawked at and wanted to know about. Some people didn't like him. He was controversial, no doubt about that, but he also dripped with appeal. You simply wanted to know what John McEnroe was doing. A success, certainly by American standards. A champion, that much was obvious. A millionaire, a personality, a celebrity. All those things, those were on the surface, clear. But beyond the general fanfare was an aspect of John's personality that did not really stick in the public eye, but its importance to him makes it important to us. The Davis Cup. This may be the part of his education that reveals the most about this young man. Let's retreat to December 1978, Rancho Mirage, California, when the United States faces Great Britain with the Davis Cup itself at stake. It's been a long drought for the United States, the longest in history, not since 1972, as the United States won this worldwide team competition. John McEnroe, who played a cameo role in the quarterfinals against Chile, winning in doubles, suddenly is catapulted into the leading role. He will play singles for the United States, says Captain Tony Traber. Not since 1939 has a teenager played in the final for the United States. Jack Kramer, then.
Can you recall that feeling walking onto the court that day?
Well, that was the first singles match I played, so I was a little nervous because I wanted, I wanted to prove that I was capable of playing the singles, because there was a question at that time whether I should be playing the match.
Now, representing the United States of America in the first singles match, Mr. John McEnroe.
Davis Cup is quite apart from any other competition. Now, the umpire will say, advantage, United States, not advantage, McEnroe. McEnroe's first opponent will be John Lloyd, a handsome Englishman who is to soon marry the American tennis heroine, Chris Everett. For openers, two aces. And then McEnroe merely gets better. He wins the first 12 points.
Formative people in Johnny McEnroe's career, of course, his mother and father, Kay, and John McEnroe Sr. His first coach is Tony Palafox, who played Davis Cup for Mexico, and of course, the old fox, Harry Hoffman, who captained more winning Davis Cup teams than any other man, 16, and is having a great influence on our young American players. But I'd like to ask Kay, you watched John, and you too, John, play that first Davis Cup match. He was the youngest man ever to play singles in a final for the United States, and what was it like to see your firstborn go out there? He's still a kid, a teenager after all, and
They say, here's for the United States, John McEnroe. What happens?
A tear in my eye.
A real
yes.
tear.
Oh, yes. Very exciting. This is the biggest thrill for us, for Johnny, to be on a Davis Cup team in the finals. Besides, wonderful. Wonderful.
I agree completely with what Kay said. It's just a complete thrill. I mean, Wimbledon was absolutely marvelous, as you remember. The first time I met you, I was there for the Connors match.
Right.
First time I saw him center court
at
Wimbledon.
It was a qualifier, and had gone all the way through, winning eight matches to the semis.
And that was marvelous, and that was historic in itself. It was a centenary Wimbledon. But there's something special about this, to us at least, the Davis Cup and representing the United States, and to be here and see it all. We brought his two brothers with us, the whole family's here. Very important and terrific.
Business affairs, I understand.
Well, so far.
Does it take up more time and energy than you figured?
Well, I suppose perhaps more than I figured, but it still doesn't take up really a lot of my time. I have a busy legal practice, which is a full-time profession for me, and I expect it will remain that. But we've been able to take care of most of his problems together, talking to the other agents who tell me that it's a mistake that I'm trying to do it myself.
Uh-huh.
The difficult part, or the most difficult part, I think, was simply becoming aware of, to put it right down at the bottom line, what the financial marketplace really was,
uh-huh.
and where things, what levels we should be thinking about.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the numbers are rather high.
Rather
and,
big.
And it was something that you didn't anticipate.
Harry and Tony, when did you first see this kid?
I saw him at 12, about the same time for you.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
This was at Long Island, Fort Washington Tennis Academy. And Tony and I were both there. And John always had this beautiful, easy, born in him, it looked, facility of stroke making. You know, John was a boy who knew what he wanted. I've always admired John for being able to speak up for himself. As a matter of fact, I have a different outlook on John than the press has. I think John is the sort of boy who's sort of man. He's a young man who can speak up for himself, and I like this. I think it's essential in a tennis player. I don't think the docile kid is ever going to be the champion.
Have you ever been ashamed of him watching him play tennis?
Not
Has his behavior ever bothered you?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. Oh,
of course.
Yes.
There are times when we're unhappy with things that happen on the court, and we make no bones about telling about it.
I want a nice little Arthur Ashe running around.
Ho, ho, ho. I don't think you're going to get that.
No, I'm not. But I'd like one. But no.
You've been dismayed. Is that the word?
Nicely put, but dismayed, yes.
Does it bother you if you read in the press that he's a punk? That's, of course, a popular expression these days anyway, which is not necessarily detrimental, but does that bother you?
Yes, of course. course.
Would it bother you if somebody wrote that about your son?
Or about me.
Right. Yeah.
People often compare him with Jimmy Connors. They're both left-handed, they're both young, they're both brash, they're both exciting to watch, and they're fighters. Both tremendous fighters on the court. Now, Connors came out, you might say, from the wrong side of the tracks.
But I take exception to the word brash with McEnroe. I think I know John well enough, and I'm sure Tony knows him well enough to feel that it is not brashness. That is the wrong word. You've got to realize that New York kids, for a start, are different to any other part of America. They're taught to battle for their own rights. Something about New York, I don't know what it is, I don't know it well enough, but I do know from the youngsters I've met from all parts of New York and New Jersey, it's like they bring them into it, they do learn early to battle for what they think is right.
To survive, perhaps, in the big city.
It may be from a sort of survival, though I don't think John had any worry about surviving.
Well, that's what I was trying to bring up with. Jimmy is a fighter and a survivor from a tough part of a tough town, and you people are people of means, and yet he's developed as a fighter, and that is interesting to me, that he has had this drive. Where do you think it comes from?
Well, he's had it always since he was a little fella. He's always been wanted to be first. Didn't matter what it was, if he was on the basketball team, he wanted to be the coach.
Talk about Johnny going straight to the top, Harry. For now, you go back further than any of us. Does this mean an all-time great, do you think?
Yes, I do. Thinking of labor and what Rod was doing at a similar age and what potential he had, what stroke making he had. I think of it in that term when I talk. I very, very seldom let my head go and talk of someone getting to the top without having a pretty good idea of it. I like to be right.
Gangling Buster Matram became Britain's hope by beating Brian Gottfried. With the United States ahead, 2-1, McEnroe can clinch it now by defeating Matram. The Davis Cup returns to the nation of its origin. It belongs once again to the United States.
John, what can you sort of describe what the victory means to you, being able to wrap it up for America?
Well, it's nice to play for your country, regardless of you know how you do. It's nicer if you win. You know, and you always want to play Davis Cup when you grow up, and you know, it was nice. It was nice to play my first singles match in the Challenger. I mean, it doesn't happen every day.
The call to Davis Cup duty will take John McEnroe around the world several times in the years to come. March 1980.
This is Buenos Aires, Argentina. We're in the stadium of the Buenos Aires Lawn Tennis Club. It's a long, long way from home. This is Davis Cup, United States against Argentina. But the first Davis Cup match played in Boston 1900 in a genteel setting. Englishmen against Americans. Blue bloods, all of them. That's what Davis Cup was then. This is Davis Cup Argentine style. The United States has won the last 2 years, 1978 and 1979. But going to South America for Americans, listen to this roll call of defeat. 1966, Brazil. 1967, Ecuador. Ecuador, the all-time loss for the United States. 1974, Colombia. 1975 and 1976, Mexico. 1977, Argentina. Jimmy Connors was so discouraged after losing in the 1976 match in Mexico City that he never returned. Davis Cup in Latin America. No picnic. McEnroe came into Buenos Aires undefeated in 3 years of Davis Cup, 14 straight matches. In his opening match, he meets Jose Luis Clerc in 6 hours. They played one set, the last set, 11-9. The fourth set took 3 hours and 9 minutes to play. How can it take so long to play one set of tennis? That is an intriguing factor about tennis in South America and in Europe too. The red clay courts, the lazy, slow bound of the ball. It takes the utmost patience, and John McEnroe is not a patient player. He wants to attack. He wants to storm the net. But you must be careful against a Jose Luis Clerc or against a Guillermo Vilas, because if you come to the net, you must be prepared. You must come in only on the best shot. Otherwise, they'll pass you. And so you stay back at the baseline, fencing, sparring, waiting for the opportunity. Concentration wavers. It erodes. The crowd is always there, hanging over your shoulder, waiting for you to fail, waiting for you to miss one shot, ready to cheer for their heroes or to boo you if you question. Tennis in Buenos Aires is no fun for an invader. John McEnroe has never lost a Davis Cup match, but he will lose today. It could happen to anybody.
Do you think people now tend to say, what the hell's wrong with McEnroe? For instance, the Argentina loss or something like that. That they now expect you to win all the time.
Well, I was, you know, I really was hoping, I mean, people say, how long could that Davis Cup string keep up and stuff like that? I was hoping it could keep up forever. Because I really enjoy playing Davis Cup, and I knew when we went down there that we were really going to have a tough match, because I know that my best serve, for one thing, for myself speaking, you know, my best service is in clay, and theirs is.
After 2 days of play, the United States trails 2-1. And so it's up to McEnroe to beat Guillermo Vilas, or Argentina wins the match. Vilas has never lost a Davis Cup match on this court. Vilas against McEnroe. They played a year before in Memphis, Tennessee. McEnroe won easily, but that was Davis Cup in the United States.
Now, the crowd was about 7,000 people, and as you've said before, everybody's for their team and probably against you. What is the feeling like being out there on the court?
There's just so much against you before you even go out on the court. I mean, just people, they're just not nonstop, but a great deal of chanting going on. I gave her what I had, and I just couldn't handle it, I guess, this specific time. But maybe, you know, a couple of years, if I have to go there, I mean, I'm not looking forward to going there again, but if he ever asked me and I went or whatever, I mean, I hope it's a different result.
Were you worried about the crowd? Did you complain about line calls as you had perhaps in the
I complained, but I mean, I complained a couple of times, but basically, it's not like you can't stop them, you know, just people just start booing. There's just no way you can do it. It's just not just, you realize that just some things you just can't do, even if you want to do.
After the match, Captain Tony Trabert of the United States had this to say. It was a damn fine match. They were out there nearly 5 hours in intense heat and humidity. It took a lot of courage to stay out there and play so well for that long. Hour after hour, right up to 4 games all in the fifth set. And there, McEnroe cracked.
Vilas won the last two games.
The way I look at it, it was a big thing for tennis in Argentina. I mean, the people really, you know, they really gave me a hard time and stuff, but I think, you know, I couldn't even, didn't even get to shake Vilas's hand, you know, after the match and stuff like that. But
because of the crowd.
Yeah, and I went in after into his locker room after to shake his hand because I thought it was like important just to get knowledge of, you know.
What a weekend for John McEnroe. On the court, more than 15 hours in singles and doubles in 3 days, losing twice, winning the doubles, trying every second of all those hours.
I was, you know, teed off by some of the things that happened, you know, but I would have complained more, let's put it that way, if I'd won the matches. I mean, I don't think it's right to complain when you lose because it's not like sour grapes. So I'd rather win and then complain. The Davis Cup thing is a great thing, and I mean, I still plan on playing the match as long as they want me, but I guess you appreciate, sometimes when you lose some of those matches, you appreciate what you've done more.
In defeat, John McEnroe matures. He is ready for the ultimate test. Let's move on to the summer of 1980, the Big W, Wimbledon. John McEnroe is not unfamiliar with the turf at Wimbledon or the crowds that surround it, and they are not unfamiliar with him. 1977, it will always be remembered in tennis. Here was the fresh kid, 18 years old, the youngest semifinalist, the only qualifier in the semis. He intended to win the Wimbledon Junior, but he did so well among the men, going all the way to the semifinals where he lost to Jimmy Connors, that he had to drop out of the juniors without hitting a ball. But he's not a qualifier now. He comes in as the number two seed. But things have not always gone so well at Wimbledon for John McEnroe. In 1978, they said of him, last year's hero is this year's zero. He lost in the first round to Eric Van Dillen. Then last year, in the fourth round, to Tim Gullickson on the Haunted House court, court two. And so McEnroe was gone from the singles. He was expected in the final last year. This year, he makes it. On the way in the semifinals, once again, in the American rivalry, Connors and McEnroe, McEnroe steps ahead. It's a dogfight. They snarl at each other. It's unpleasant. But in the final, all is different. The respect again, McEnroe and Borg. Will these two live up to the poetic demands of Rudyard Kipling, as posted on a signboard at the entrance to Center Court, the land of if? So many things can go right, so many things can go wrong. Only one will emerge the champion. Kipling said it this way, if you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too, or being lied about, don't deal in lies, or being hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good nor talk too wise. If you can dream and not make dreams your master, if you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat those two impostors just the same, or watch the things you gave your life to broken and stoop and build them up with worn-out tools. If you can make one heap of all your winnings and risk it on one term of pitch and toss and lose, start again at your beginnings and never breathe a word about your loss. If you can force your heart and nerve and sinew and so hold on when there's nothing in you accept the will which says to them, hold on. If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings, nor lose the common touch. If neither foes nor loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you but none too much, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it, which is more, you'll be a man, my son. If you had seen every Wimbledon final since 1877, you still wouldn't have seen a better one than this. The people who'd gone back, oh, years and years and years, almost to the beginning of the century, they said nothing could compare with this Borg-McEnroe battle. An epic that really both men won. If McEnroe had gotten the break points in the second set and taken a 2-sets-to-love lead, if the Swede weren't so resolute when he was pushed and pushed and pushed and lost that fourth set in the 18-16 tiebreaker, the ifs were strewn all over the court, and when it was over, Borg was the champion for a fifth consecutive year, but John McEnroe had walked onto the court, still a kid that wasn't liked very much in England, a player who was booed when he walked onto the court. And when he left a respected man. Well then, let's have a last look at the boy, retreating to 1978, that Davis Cup final, when he became the youngest to carry the United States to the revered Davis Cup. Perhaps there will never be a glow again quite like this. Davis Cup 1978 is all over. How did you feel?
Well, I guess it's the first singles match I ever played, and you know, I lost less games than anyone else or whatever, so people, I mean, it was kind of easy in a way, you know, it was just, It really went the way I wanted to go. I mean, I wanted to be over quick. My mother, you know, she hates watching me play. She likes watching those quick matches.
But so. Did you feel mellow? Was it special?
Oh, I felt really, I mean, that was one of the high points in tennis because the first time I really played for my country and I'd done really well and people couldn't say they made a mistake. And I mean, the whole feeling was great. I mean, just picking up the Davis Cup with Stan and Bob, you know, and those guys have won it like five other times. So it was a good feeling that I contributed in that. I mean, then the week after that was the cover of Sports Illustrated, and it was nice for people to say, like, did you play Davis Cup, and it was nice for a chance that, you know, I did something nice. I guess that was the main thing, that I'm not, like, that bad a guy after all.